I said Dr. Lex is going to present the book in CCJ.
Mm-hmm, he told me.
Yeah. He said he'll find a way.
Please remain standing for the national anthem, which will be performed by the students of the Convent High School. Miss Michelle Morancy will sing, and Miss Brea Evans and J.D. Laura will sign the national anthem.
Oh,
may be seated, and we thank the students of the Convent High School for this excellent presentation of the national anthem. I now invite Monsignor Eustace Thomas to do the opening prayer.
We brought here this morning in the name of the Blessed Trinity, that is, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. From Deuteronomy chapter 1, verse 16, quote, "And I charged your judges at that time, hear the disputes between your people and the judge fairly, whether the case is between the two Israelites or between an Israelite and a foreigner residing among you," end of quote. The 16th chapter of the same book. I quote, "Appoint judges and officials for each of the tribes in every town the Lord your God is giving you, and they shall judge the people fairly. Do not pervert justice or show partiality. Do not accept a bribe, for a bribe blinds the eyes of the wise and twists the words of the innocent. Follow justice and justice alone," end of quote. Could you please stand? Let us pray in the words Christ taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Let us pray. Almighty, eternal God, and legislator of legislators, we rejoice that in response to the promptings of your Holy Spirit, the government appointed by you has brought us here to mark Dominica's accession to the appellate jurisdiction of the Caribbean Court of Justice. Father, on this historic day which we dedicate to you, cleanse the misconception of those who still challenge the impartiality of this court in its administration of justice. Rather, we ask you to elucidate their understanding of the Caribbean Court of Justice as an important instrument of integration and our own independence, because we now have a court that has been designed by ourselves, managed by ourselves, thus indicating to the world that we are mature enough to handle our affairs in every facet of our development. O God of justice and truth, infuse into the judiciary the wisdom of Solomon, so that by interpreting and applying the law, disputes will be resolved and your people will joyfully experience the full process of the justice system. Good and gracious God, we present this ceremony into your hands and ask that you protect our guests, our visitors, our leaders, and the entire nation from all harm. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen.
You may be seated. Your Excellency Charles Angelo Savarin, President of the Commonwealth of Dominica and Mrs. Savarin, Honourable Roosevelt Skerrit, Prime Minister of Dominica, the Right Honourable Sir Charles Michael Dennis Byron, President of the Caribbean Court of Justice, and Lady Byron, Honourable Justices of the Caribbean Court of Justice, Your Ladyship, the Honourable Justice Dame Janice Pereira, Chief Justice of the Eastern Caribbean Supreme Court, Honourable Alex Boyd Knights, Speaker of the House of Assembly, Your Lordship, Most Reverend Gabriel Malzer, Bishop of Roseau, Dr. Francis Alexis, QC, featured speaker at this event, Your Excellency Eliud Williams, former President of the Commonwealth of Dominica, and Mrs. Williams, Mrs. Verna Liverpool, spouse of former President Dr. Nicholas Liverpool, Honourable Rayburn Blackmore, Minister for Justice, Immigration, and National Security, and Mrs. Blackmore, Honourable Francine Byron, Minister for Foreign Affairs and CARICOM Affairs, Honourable Levi Peter, Attorney General, Honourable Ministers of Cabinet, Honourable Lennox Linton, Leader of the Parliamentary Opposition, Your Excellency Ambassador Irwin LaRocque, Secretary General of the Caribbean Community, CARICOM, Your Excellencies, the members of the Diplomatic and Consular Corps and spouses, Honourable members of the House of Assembly and spouses, Justices Bernie Stevenson and Errol Thomas, resident judges, Monsignor Eustace Thomas, who led us in prayer, Your Worship Irene John, Mayor of the City of Roseau, Ambassador Steve Farrell, Secretary to the Cabinet, and Mrs. Farrell, Permanent Secretaries, Mrs. Mikkel Henderson Del Sol and Mr. Del Sol, Senior Counsels, members of the Bar Association, members of the media, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. We are gathered here to mark this historic occasion of the accession of the Commonwealth of Dominica to the Caribbean Court of Justice. And to welcome us here this morning, I invite the Honourable A.G. Levi Peter.
Your Excellency Charles Angelo Savarin, President of the Commonwealth of Dominica, and Mrs. Savarin, Honourable Roosevelt Skerrit, Prime Minister, the Right Honourable Sir Charles Michael Dennis Byron, President of the Caribbean Court of Justice, and Lady Byron, the Honourable Justices of the Caribbean Court of Justice, Your Ladyship, the Honourable Justice Dame Janice Pereira, Chief Justice of the Eastern Caribbean Supreme Court, Honourable Alex Boyd Knights, Speaker of the House of Assembly, Your Lordship, Most Reverend Gabriel Malzaire, Bishop of Roseau, Dr. Francis Alexis, QC, featured speaker at this event, Your Excellency Eliud Williams, former President of the Commonwealth of Dominica, and Mrs. Williams, Mrs. Verna Liverpool, spouse of former President Dr. Nicholas Liverpool, Honourable Rayburn Blackmore, Minister for Justice, Immigration, and National Security, and Mrs. Blackmore, Honourable Francine Byron, Minister for Foreign Affairs and CARICOM Affairs, Honourable Ministers of Cabinet, Honourable Lennox Linton, Leader of the Parliamentary Opposition, Your Excellency Ambassador Irwin LaRocque, Secretary General of the Caribbean Community CARICOM, Your Excellencies, Members of the Diplomatic Corps and Consular Corps and spouses, Honourable Members of the House of Assembly and spouses, Justices Bernie Stevenson and Errol Thomas, resident judges, Monsignor Eustace Thomas, Your Worship, Irene John, Mayor of the City of Roseau, Ambassador Steve Farrell, Secretary to the Cabinet, and Mrs. Farrell, Permanent Secretaries, Mrs. Mikhail Henderson Del Sol and Mr. Del Sol, Senior Counsels, members of the Bar Association, members of the media, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. May I, on my own behalf, but more particularly on behalf of the government and people of Dominica, welcome you all here today to this special occasion marking the accession of Dominica to the Caribbean Court of Justice, CCJ. A very special welcome to our visiting guests. I trust that you have taken the opportunity to avail yourself of all the splendor and delights of Dominica. It's a beautiful gem of the Caribbean. If you have not yet done so, then I strongly urge you to do so before you depart these shores. You certainly will not be disappointed. This occasion formally marks and celebrates the momentous accession of Dominica to the Caribbean Court of Justice, a significant developmental milestone in our history. Contrary to the claims of many, it is the actual position that the establishment of the Caribbean Court of Justice is a process that has taken many years, and it has been a long journey to arriving at the point that the court was established and arriving at this point where Dominica has become the fourth jurisdiction to accede to the final appellate jurisdiction of the Caribbean Court of Justice. Indeed, the records will show that as long ago as 1901, from my research, it indicates the 6th of March of 1901, the Jamaican Daily Gleaner, in an editorial, opined as follows. Thinking men believe that the Judicial Committee has served its turn and is now out of joint with the conditions of the times. Latterly, the character of the appeals have varied very much and have involved questions of complex legal range and jurisprudence, which are altogether different from the principles in force in England, close quotes. That tells its own story. That is 1901. It was recognized that the Privy Council perhaps was not best suited to address all particular circumstances. In the situation as it relates to Dominica, many of you may recall that as long ago as 2004, September 2004 to be precise, Dominica sought to accede to the appellate jurisdiction of the CCJ. Sadly, that attempt was ill-fated since the legislators at the time failed or omitted to follow the strict provisions of the Constitution in terms of the requirements to achieve that goal. And Dominica, blessed as it was at the time, with a learned and wise president, was saved from perhaps an embarrassing fate. The president recognized that the proper procedures and requirements had not been followed and returned the bill from whence it came for a reconsideration. That reconsideration has taken us some 10 years to get to the point where we now have passed legislation complying with the requirements of the Constitution and fulfilling the requirements and bringing us to this stage where we can gather to mark this momentous and historic occasion. The final piece of the jigsaw was the commencement order, which is commencement order SRO 4 of 2015, for those of you who are that inclined and wish to note it, if you haven't yet done so, which took effect from the 27th of February of 2015. And today's event is really celebrating and marking that final piece of the jigsaw, bringing us finally to under the appellate jurisdiction of the Caribbean Court of Justice. So with the actions taken, we in Dominica and indeed the wider region can say, although some of them will have to join us, but we can say from our perspective in Dominica that we bid farewell to the Privy Council or former final appellate court. We say a hearty thank you to that noble court and the government and people of the United Kingdom for the service and jurisprudence that the Privy Council has provided to us and as a people and as a country over many years. But more particularly, we say a joyous welcome to this auspicious new dawn. We say welcome to leaving behind perhaps the last vestige of our colonial governance. We say welcome to our accession to the appellate jurisdiction of the CCJ. We especially say welcome to Dominica's coming of age. We in Dominica can now look forward to exercising our judicial rights, our entitlements, our own justice, jurisprudence, and protection of the rule of law under the guidance of the Caribbean Court of Justice, CCJ. This will be a critical element to our continued development, and I'm sure that we will all do the best we can to ensure that the court continues to develop, continues to provide for us in terms of our jurisprudence, in terms of the justice in this region, in terms of ensuring that we continue to be governed as a country under the rule of law, that we continue to be free and continue to enjoy the democratic rights and freedoms that we have done for many, many decades. I leave you with the words of Isabel Davila, in her paper, Replacing the Privy Council with the Caribbean Court of Justice in the OECS Countries, a paper in the Emerging Caribbean Direction and Purpose for 21st Century Caribbean Studies Associated, where she stated as follows, the Privy Council may have been a useful institution during the colonial era. However, due to the changes that both Europe and the Caribbean have undergone, its presence in the jurisdiction of the Caribbean is part of the colonial legacy of the last century. It would be in the best interests of all Caribbean nations, including those of the Organization of Eastern Caribbean States, to join in and create a Caribbean Court of Justice that will lead these nations to strengthen their democratic institutions, develop economically, socially, and politically, in addition to achieving a higher level of justice. Welcome.
We thank the Honourable Attorney General Levi Peter for his words of welcome. For the Caribbean Community CARICOM, history was created with the debut of the first ever CARICOM song titled Celebrating CARICOM. The CARICOM song competition was launched in April 2013 as part of the community's 40th anniversary celebrations. The goal was to facilitate the involvement of CARICOM countries in choosing a regionally and internationally recognized song that promoted unity and inspired CARICOM identity and pride. A regional panel of judges comprising independent experts in music was nominated by member states and the CARICOM Secretariat to choose the CARICOM song. The competition was conducted in three rounds, where 63 entries were condensed to the final three, of which Celebrating CARICOM, composed by Dominica's talented songwriter, vocalist, and flutist, Mrs. Mikkel Henderson Del Sol, was chosen as the winner. Very often, we hear of men achievers giving credit to their spouses or partners for their supportive roles. Therefore, it would be remiss of me if mention was not made of Mikkel's husband, Roland Del Sol Jr., for his collaborative support in the production of this masterpiece, as well as Mikkel's band and other music colleagues in Dominica. At this time, I am pleased to present to you Dominica's pride, Mikkel Henderson Del Sol, as she presents Celebrating CARICOM.
Distant lands, our forefathers came. Some seeking adventure, some bound in chains. Through battles waged and fought, through victory and pain, by test of their courage, our freedom was gained. In homage to those gone before us, the heroes of lands in the sun, we vow to join hands and to focus on building one Caribbean. Raise your voices high and sing up your Caribbean pride. Feel our hearts beat as one. Celebrate in song as we rise to heights where we belong. Sound the victory drum for CARICOM. The great and diverse speed, our ethnicities, the bonds that unite us are stronger than these. play, we relate to each other the West Indian way. Today, as a people united, determined and steadfast, we stand. We look to a brand new horizon, the future now firmly in our hands. Raise your voices high and sing of your Caribbean pride. Sing it loud and strong. Feel our hearts beat as one. Celebrate in song as we rise to heights where we your voices high and sing up your Caribbean pride. Sing it loud and strong. Feel our hearts beat as one. Celebrate in song as we rise to heights where we belong. Sound of victory drum. Oppo you sing caricom, lefele beva, hele, hele, tambu ye tambu awo, maki u don caricom, lefele.
Congratulations again, Mikhail. Congratulations, CARICOM, and thank you for your presentation of the CARICOM song. So the Right Honourable Sir Dennis Byron is President of the Caribbean Court of Justice. I now invite him to address us.
Thank you, and a Master of Ceremonies. Your Excellency, Charles Angelo Savarin, the President of the Commonwealth of Dominica, and Mrs. Savarin. Honourable Roosevelt Skerrit, Prime Minister. Honourable Justices of the Caribbean Court of Justice. Your Ladyship, the Honourable Dame Janice Pereira, Chief Justice of the Eastern Caribbean Supreme Court, Honourable Alex Boyd Knights, Speaker of the House of Assembly, Your Lordship, Most Reverend Gabriel Marzier, Bishop of Brussels, Dr. Francis Alexis QC, Featured Speaker at this event, Your Excellency, Elliot Williams, former President of the Commonwealth of Dominica, and Mrs. Williams, Mrs. Verna Liverpool, spouse of former President, Dr. Nicholas Liverpool, Honorable Raymond Blackmore, Minister for Justice, Immigration, and National Security, and Mrs. Blackmore, Honorable Francine Baron, Minister of Foreign Affairs and CARICOM Affairs, Honourable Levi Peter, Attorney General, Honourable Ministers of Cabinet, Honourable Lennox Linton, Leader of the Parliamentary Opposition, Your Excellency, Ambassador Urban Larocque, Secretary General of the CARICOM Community, Your Excellencies, the members of the Diplomatic and Consular Corps and their spouses, Honourable members of the House of Assembly and spouses, Justices, the Honourable Bernie Stevenson and Eric Thomas, resident judges, Monsignor Eustace Thomas, Your Worship, Irene John, Mayor of the City of Roseau, Ambassador Steve Ferral, Secretary to the Cabinet, and Mrs. Ferral, Permanent Secretaries, Mrs. Michelle Henderson Delsal and Mr. Delsal, thank you for that wonderful and exciting song. Senior Counsel, members of the Bar Association, members of the media, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. It's a real pleasure to be standing here today on this really momentous occasion. I want to congratulate Dominica. I want to say a really special word of thanks for inviting me to participate and share in this really tremendous celebration. I'm delighted. In a certain way, the Caribbean Court of Justice has always been your court. But today, it is completely your court in every respect. And it is now the final Court of Appeal for the Commonwealth of Dominica. The court as a whole appreciates the significance of this occasion. And our court, our whole court, is here with me to join you in solidarity on this occasion. And so I'm really pleased to be able to present to you and to the whole nation of Dominica, the judges and the registrar of the court who are here sharing in the ceremony. I'd like to first of all present the Honorable Justice Russell Nelson. The Honourable Justice Adrian Saunders. The Honourable Justice Jacob Witt. The Honourable Justice David Hayton. And the Honourable Justice Winston Anderson. The Honourable Justice Maureen Ragarath Lee is being sworn in on the 27th of March, and she's here with us in spirit, I'm sure. I would also like to present to you the learned and distinguished registrar of our court, Mrs. Jacqueline Graham. And she has brought with her the Registry Supervisor, Mr. Nandiel Hadia. Well, we are here to serve you, and we really appreciate the opportunity, Mr. Prime Minister. Now, in addition to the accession of Dominica to the appellate jurisdiction of the Caribbean Court of Justice, there's another cause for celebration here today. And it is the publication of the second edition of Dr. Francis Alexis's book, Commonwealth Caribbean Constitutional Law. I think it's a fitting coincidence that an OECS citizen can be celebrated in tandem with the recognition of this momentous OECS achievement. I am delighted that this great scholar is part of the ceremony. It's a further demonstration of the international standard of our jurists and their contribution to knowledge and to the development of Caribbean jurisprudence. Contributions that are consistent with the mandate of the Caribbean Court of Justice. So I extend my congratulations to Dr. Alexis. And I am sure that his book will continue to illuminate the often tricky path of Caribbean constitutional jurisprudence. One of the Caribbean luminaries, and in fact, an illustrious Dominican jurist, the Right Honourable Telford Georges, regarded it as a compromise of sovereignty for Caribbean nations to remain wedded to a court which is part of the former colonial hierarchy. One of our contemporary leaders, Dr. Kenny Anthony, Prime Minister of St. Lucia, put it this way. The court has always been about, the court, that is the CCJ, has always been about the need for all the peoples of CARICOM to assert their confidence in their integrity, their civilization, and in themselves. No self-respecting nation should allow its sovereignty to be at large. In that context, Honorable Prime Minister, I extend my congratulations to the people of Dominica. To the Honorable Roosevelt Skerrit, Prime Minister of Dominica. And to the entire government and establishment in Dominica. On this definitive step, completing the circle of its independence. You have taken on the mantle of leadership in the Eastern Caribbean. I understand, Mr. Prime Minister, that this coincides with your current chairmanship of the OECS. And so it's fitting that your chairmanship is characterized by this accomplishment. Since I'm in this congratulatory mood, I should add one other point for your consideration. This year is the 10th anniversary of the Caribbean Court of Justice. Our anniversary date is the 16th of April, but we have decided to celebrate for the whole year. So it's a fitting coincidence that the accession of Dominica to the final appellate jurisdiction of the court has become an important part of our 10th anniversary celebrations. St. Kitts, St. Lucia, St. Vincent have constitutional arrangements identical to Dominica and can follow the same path that has now been so brilliantly illuminated. Grenada, with different constitutional procedures, is moving forward on its path to full accession. And a strong commitment to do the same has been expressed by Prime Minister Gaston Brown of Antigua. I really hope that this demonstrates that the momentum is growing throughout our region to complete the independence process. And I wish Jamaica well in its deliberations and fully trust that the exercise of political maturity will accrue to the benefit of its citizens. I've been advised that there has been some effort to educate the public here in Dominica about the Criminal Court of Justice. So it is not necessary for me to say too much on this occasion. But I'd really merely recall that the Caribbean Court of Justice has two separate and distinct jurisdictions. It has an original jurisdiction in which it adjudicates on disputes arising with respect to the interpretation and application of the revised Treaty of Chagaramas, which is established our Caribbean community, single market, and single market. So far, 10 cases have been filed under the court's original jurisdiction. And one example which has attracted a lot of attention throughout the region has been the case of Shanique Myrie against the state of Barbados, where the court determined that CARICOM nationals have a right to an automatic stay within member states of 6 months, subject to showing that the said national is not likely to become a charge on the public purse of the accepting country and does not fall within restrictively interpreted class of undesirable persons. The other jurisdiction is the appellate jurisdiction, where the court sits as a final court of appeal. And in this capacity, it replaces the Privy Council. Now, this jurisdiction has been well used in the three countries that have preceded Dominica in accepting this jurisdiction. That is Guyana, Barbados, and Belize. And already, there have been 151 cases that have been filed under our appellate jurisdiction. The CCJ is an independent court. It's not part of the domestic affairs of any member state. Its independence is assured by the institutional arrangements for the appointment of judges and by the character of the judges who have been selected in a competitive process and appointed. The selection process is competitive, transparent, rigorously transparent, and is completely free from political control or influence. In fact, scholars, international scholars, have been heralding the CCJ as an international model court. The main feature of the selection process is an independent and non-partisan body, the Regional Judicial and Legal Services Commission, a commission which comprises 11 persons. The president of the Caribbean Court of Justice is ex officio chairman. None of the other commissioners are appointed by any government. They are nominated independently by institutions within our region. And I should mention that the distinguished Dr. Lloyd Barnett of Jamaica is the longest serving member of the commission, having been nominated by the law schools among the first members of the commission, and his nomination has been repeated over the years. The CCJ offers increased access to justice for the people of the Caribbean. This is very evident in the countries where the CCJ is already the final court. Unlike the Privy Council, ordinary folk have been bringing their cases before the Caribbean Court of Justice. It is not only governments and big business who are litigants before our court. Many cases have come from Barbados, Guyana, and Belize, where people have brought their personal, domestic, land disputes before a court for justice. And I can assure you, proudly assure you, that our court is accessible to anyone who has a legitimate dispute that is worthy of adjudication at the highest level of justice. The CCJ is a modern court. It's a high-tech court. Cases in the CCJ can be heard online. Trials and case management conferences are conducted by video link. Official transcript of our proceedings is in the form of a video or audio record. And these transcripts are available on the court's website the same night of proceedings, providing transparency and access to the public at large. Anyone can access these records by visiting the court's website. And people have been accessing the court's webpage. My assistant, judicial assistant, showed me a statistical report which revealed that over the past 3 years, the CCJ's website has been visited by over 66,000 individual users who viewed 483,523 pages. And, Mr. Prime Minister, 2,110 of these page views originated right here in Dominica. The technological and other innovations embraced by the CCJ have not come about by accident. They reflect the result of thoughtful planning and careful implementation of the court's strategic plan. A plan focused, among other things, to ensuring access to justice, independence, and accountability, and attaining and preserving public trust and confidence, and enhancing regional justice system performance. We believe that the court will serve the citizens of Dominica well. We believe that it's a well-functioning judiciary, which, like all well-functioning judiciaries, contributes to economic development and social stability. And we sincerely hope and trust that Dominica will derive these benefits from our operations here. Yesterday, just yesterday, we came in a bit early for this meeting, Mr. Prime Minister, and we held two training sessions at the court. The first one was for the registry staff of the High Court, and the second was for members of the Bar Association. Our objective was to sensitize them to the procedural rules of the Caribbean Court of Justice and to demonstrate filing procedures and techniques that are used in our electronic court folders. Providing this type of educational service is part of the strategic objective of our court, as we intend to support and drive the improvement of justice delivery services in our region. But today, I do not want to distract from the moment of celebration. Let us celebrate the accession of Dominica to the Caribbean Court of Justice. I suppose that we can marry the ancient with the modern, because an ancient Latin phrase encapsulates the power and import of judicial independence, the same independence that characterizes the court. Fiat justitia ruat caelium. which being translated means, let justice reign though the heavens fall. Dominica's decision to accept both jurisdictions in the Caribbean Court of Justice is a step forward for Dominica, for the OECS, and for the region. I congratulate you and bid you a warm welcome to the court.
We thank the Right Honourable Sir Dennis Byron for this high level of clarity that you have given to the role, objectives, benefits, and operations of the CCJ. Thank you once again. Dr. Francis Alexis QC breezed into the world on a small tropical island known as the Spice Island of the Caribbean, Grenada, on October 3rd, 1947. He was schooled in Grenada up to secondary level and then moved to Barbados, where he commenced tertiary academic studies at the University of the West Indies, leading to a Bachelor of Arts degree, honors degree in 1971, an LLB in 1973, and an LLM in 1976. In 1977, he obtained the Legal Education Certificate, LEC, at the Hugh Wooden Law School in Trinidad and Tobago, and completed his education pursuits with a PhD in public law in 1980 at the University of Cambridge, England. Dr. Alexis was admitted to practice as a barrister at law before the Supreme Court in Grenada on December 10, 1980. Thus starting a distinguished career in law spanning over three decades. His service includes private practice, senior lecturer in law at the Cave Hill and St. Augustine campuses of the University of the West Indies, course director, advanced administrative law, master of law in public law at Cave Hill, and adjunct professor of international law and public health at the St. George's University School of Medicine, Grenada. He also served as Law Revision Commissioner and Attorney General of Grenada. He has appeared as counsel in numerous reported cases and was also cited by court in the case Blake versus Barker. He mastered the skill in mediation and arbitration through his practice in mediation counsel from 2004 and Arbitration Council from 2000. Dr. Alexis is a practical exponent of the highly specialized art of legal drafting and served as the chairman of the committee which drafted the proposed 2009 Constitution of St. Vincent and the Grenadines to reform the 1979 Independence Constitution passed by the House of Assembly of the Parliament of St. Vincent and the Grenadines on September 3, 2009, but not approved in the referendum in September of that same year. Laws drafted by Dr. Alexis without precedent currently in force include Constitutional Judicature Restoration Act 1991 of Grenada, Act Restoring Constitutional Judicature to Grenada with Special Necessary Adjustments, and the Public Festivals Regulation Act 1994 of Grenada. Laws drafted by Dr. Alexis with precedent currently in force include Status of Children Act 1991 of Grenada, an act ensuring that whether born in or out of wedlock, a child is a child. He has also drafted laws without precedent and enacted but not yet proclaimed. Dr. Alexis served as legal consultant to the Government of Grenada on constitution reform, Government of Grenada on local government law reform, Government of St. Vincent and the Grenadines on constitution reform, Government of Trinidad and Tobago on the Environmental Commission and the Judicial Review Act of 2000, the OECS Secretariat on OECS Non-Independent Member States Constitutional Issues on Strengthening and Deepening OECS, OECS Secretariat on the Creating of an OECS Regional Police Service, OECS Secretariat on the Implications for the OECS of the Abolition of the Office of the Lord Chancellor and the Council of Legal Education under Professor Sir O. Roy Marshall, Commonwealth Caribbean Legal Education Review Consultations, 1981. His law publications include books such as Eastern Caribbean Supreme Court, Model Regional Court, The Constitution and You, Grenada, H. Aubrey Fraser, Eminent Caribbean Jurist, Changing Caribbean Constitutions. He co-edited the book Commonwealth Caribbean Legal Essays and published numerous journal articles on the law in various law journals in the Caribbean, United States of America, Europe, and Asia. He provided exemplary governmental and parliamentary service to the state as acting Prime Minister of Grenada on numerous occasions during the period March 1990 to June 1995. Cabinet Minister of Grenada, elected Member of Parliament in the House of Representatives, and leader Grenada delegation to the United Nations General Assembly in 1993. Dr. Alexis served as a resource person in judicial education seminars, delivering papers on public law to the judiciary in Trinidad and Tobago and in Guyana. He has attended numerous conferences in the Caribbean and internationally on law, governance, democracy, and development, and has delivered papers at several of those conferences. As part of his social responsibility and commitment, he has been providing pupillage to law students since 1985. He engages in bar activities and served as both president and vice president of the Grenada Bar Association, and participates in and otherwise assists with various voluntary community building activities. Dr. Alexis has been honored as one of the world's most distinguished personalities by certain of the world's most prestigious sources, including the International Who's Who and Who's Who in the World. Of course, his biography could not end without exposing his lighter side. He is an avid player of music on the harmonica, the mouth organ, and enjoys the singing, songwriting, and flower gardening. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Dr. Francis Alexis QC to deliver the feature address.
She left out the most important part, that I am a former Calypso king. Your Excellency, Charles Angelo Savarin, President of the Commonwealth of Dominica and Mr. Savarin, the Honourable Roosevelt Skerrit, Prime Minister of the Commonwealth of Dominica. Right Honourable Sir Charles Michael Dennis Byron, President of the Caribbean Court of Justice, and Lady Byron. Honourable Justices of the Caribbean Court of Justice. Your Ladyship, the Honourable Justice Dame Janice Pereira, Chief Justice of the Eastern Caribbean Supreme Court. Honourable Alex Boyd Knight, Speaker of the House of Assembly. Your Lordship, Most Reverend Gabriel Malze, Bishop of Roseau. Your Excellency Elliot Williams, former President of the Commonwealth of Dominica, and Mrs. Williams. Mrs. Verna Liverpool, spouse of the former President, Dr. Nicholas Liverpool. Honourable Raven Blackmore, Minister for Justice, Immigration and National Security, and Mrs. Blackmore. Honourable Francine Byron, Minister for Foreign Affairs and CARICOM Affairs. Honourable Levi Peter, Attorney General of the Commonwealth of Dominica. Honourable Ministers of Cabinet. Honourable Lennox Linton, Leader of the Parliamentary Opposition. Your Excellency, Ambassador Erwin LaRocque, Secretary General of the CARICOM Community, CARICOM. Your Excellencies, the members of the Diplomatic and Consular Corps and spouses. Honourable members of the House of Assembly and spouses. Justices Bernie Stevenson and Errol Thomas, resident judges here. Monsignor Eustace Thomas. Your Worship Irene John, Mayor of the City of Roseau. Ambassador Steve Farrell, Secretary to the Cabinet, and Mrs. Farrell. Permanent Secretaries, Mrs. Michelle Henderson Del Sol, who reminded me of the days when I was a good Calypso King. And Mr. Del Sol, senior counsels, members of the Bar Association of Dominica, members of the media, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. Ordinarily, one would simply adopt the protocol, but this is not an ordinary day. This is a very special day for all of us, not only here assembled, but who might even hear about this day. The government of the Commonwealth of the Sovereign Democratic Republic of Dominica, led by the Honourable Roosevelt Skerrit, Prime Minister, and the whole nation of Dominica, rightly today celebrate that uniquely historic event coming up on the 27th of this month. On that most significant day, with the authority of the Constitution of Dominica, on provisions enacted by the Parliament of Dominica, Dominica will constitute at its final appellate court, the Caribbean Court of Justice, in its appellate jurisdiction, and in your case, directly replacing the Judicial Committee of the Privy Council. And that is what will transform that day into a particularly momentous milestone in the annals of the history, not only of Dominica, but of the entire Caribbean. The indigenous Amerindian people of Dominica, the Kalinagos, called Caribs by the English, had their own local final appellate jurisdiction, whatever it was. And so the spirits of the chiefs and the councils of those days must be rejoicing to see final appellate judicial decision-making return to Dominica regionally. This is a day which was looked forward to earnestly by that distinguished son of Dominica, who was a juristic living legend in his time, who served in such capacities as Professor of Law, UWI, Chief Justice of Tanzania, Chief Justice of Zimbabwe, Judge of the United Kingdom Privy Council, and Chairman of the Dominica Constitution Reform Commission, the Right Honourable P. Telford Georges. He must be looking down upon us with that magical smile he had. This is a day which was called for passionately in that presidential address to the House of Assembly of Dominica in 2012 by the state president, a former university law teacher, and Justice of Appeal of the Eastern Caribbean Supreme Court, an eminent jurist, Dr. Nicholas Liverpool. This is no simple day. When in 1759, England, later Great Britain and the United Kingdom, entered Dominica, England brought with its colonialism its own final appellate court. That was Her Majesty's Privy Council, its judicial committee, the Judicial Committee of the Privy Council, also known as the United Kingdom Privy Council. JCPC originated as the final court of appeal for British colonies at least from 1972. And it has been, from inception, if I may quote that distinguished Canadian jurist Bora Laskin, writing in 1951, before he became Chief Justice of Canada, adopting his words and adapting them to today's circumstances, he was speaking about badges of colonialism. And the Privy Council was par excellence, a badge of British colonialism. And the first time members of the Privy Council in London were required to have judicial qualifications was by an act of the UK Parliament in 1833, which stipulated that members of the Judicial Committee of the Privy Council should hold or have held high judicial office in the United Kingdom or in the colonies. Now that year was significant because later that year, the United Kingdom Parliament passed another act concerning us in the Caribbean, this time abolishing slavery, which heralded the forward march to independence. So you could see that the British themselves were linking the Privy Council with what was going on in, among other places, the Caribbean. By a United Kingdom Act of 1876, the Law Lords of the Appellate Committee of the House of Lords, United Kingdom's final court until 2009, were made permanent judges of the UKPC. Again, you will note that 2009 in the United Kingdom was not all that far from 2005 in the Caribbean, when the Caribbean Court of Justice was getting going. By what may be called an earlier independence clause in a 1931 UK Act, the very famous Statute of Westminster 1931, no future UK Act of Parliament was going to extend or be deemed to extend to any dominion, Canada, Australia, New Zealand, South Africa, etc., except expressly at the request and with the consent of such dominion. So we may call that an earlier independence clause. In 1935, though, the Privy Council propounded the dictum that the United Kingdom Parliament could repeal or disregard that clause. Their lordships did add that this was so as a matter of abstract theory and had no relation to reality. But the fact that their lordships envisaged that that clause could be repealed at all meant that the Privy Council was serving the interests of the sovereignty of the United Kingdom Parliament over what independence the Dominions thought they had. Therefore, 14 years later, Canada cut off all appeals to the Privy Council with the spirit of that 1935 dictum haunting the Canadians. And Canada made its Supreme Court, and I quote Borelaskin in his own words, a final court of and for Canadians. Now, Prime Minister, it is as simple as that. When an independent country gets its own final court, it is getting a court finally of and for its people. And that is what Borelaskin is writing there. The spirit of that 1935 UKPC dictum persists to have UKPC appeals endure. In 1963, the Chief Justice of Ceylon, Sri Lanka, said in a certain decision that independence is the handmaid of the cutting off of appeals to the Privy Council. The lordships of the Privy Council didn't mince matters with him in a case called Ibrelebe VR. It all depends, you see, on what eyes you are looking at the phenomenon with. If you are looking with British eyes, you see one perspective. If you are looking with eyes of an independent country, chances are you see another perspective. That is what happened again in the year 2005, when three Jamaican acts reached the Privy Council, intended to cut off appeals to the Privy Council and to replace them with appeals to the CCJ. The more things change, the more they remain the same, whether it's 1935, 1963, 2005, and that is the way it always would be with human beings. That's how we were shaped. The point then, Mr. President, is that abolishing UKPC appeals is about completing your independence. A Briton, Keith Patchett, writing in 1963, he was then senior lecturer in law at the University of Sheffield in England. He became the first founding dean of the Faculty of Law, UWI, in 1971. Put it this way, and I quote, if the executive is to enjoy the independence from the United Kingdom, it is just as important that the judiciary should enjoy it too. Now, I have a good reason for quoting Borelaskin of Canada and Keith Patchett of England, so that you do not go away with the idea that those who talk about delinking from the Privy Council and joining up with the CCJ as part of completing independence is a matter for Caribbean hotheads. Nobody could be more sober than Borelaskin. Nobody could be more sober than Keith Patchett. A people who are truly independent have dignity in themselves, and they foster such dignity. Dignity carries self-esteem, self-worth, self-pride, self-confidence, self-image, self-respect. They do not harbor the self-doubt which breeds the belief that final appellate decision-making dispenses proper justice only if it comes from their previous colonial masters. And this is a point stressed by the President of the State of Dominica in 2012, delivering his presidential address to the House of Assembly, my former colleague, Dr. Nicholas Liverpool. That an independent people should not be in self-doubt is particularly applicable to the Caribbean. Because, Your Excellency, the Caribbean is the home of distinguished jurists. It would take us the whole day list the people from the Caribbean who have distinguished themselves internationally. It was Caribbean jurists, not the Privy Council, who pronounced foundational doctrines of Caribbean constitutional law since independence. These are that what is supreme is not Parliament, but the Constitution. That the courts have a duty to review acts of Parliament for alleged inconsistency with the Constitution, and in a proper case, strike them down as void for unconstitutionality. When that was said by the Wooden Court of Trinidad and Tobago, that court did not even have a supreme law clause, such as what Chief Justice Marshall of the United States Supreme Court had in the U.S. Constitution when he, in Marshall and Marbury, laid down a similar doctrine. So that the Wooden Court had to find this in the interstices of the Constitution, not in any express provision. It was the same Wooden Court who told the Governor General in 1964 that he certainly might be the representative of Her Majesty, but that even he, Governor General, though he be, is not immune from suit, barring express provision to the contrary. That is a court of true grit. We don't have to wait for the Privy Council to teach us that. Many Caribbean jurists have been sitting on the Privy Council itself. One of them is a juristic mentioned earlier, the Right Honourable P. Telford Georges, son of the soil of Dominica. Another is a former Chief Justice of the Eastern Caribbean Supreme Court, the Right Honourable Sir Vincent Flossack of St. Lucia. Yet another is a former Chief Justice of the Eastern Caribbean Supreme Court, who is now the President of the Caribbean Court Justice, the Right Honourable Sir Dennis Byron of St. Kitts and Nevis. And I mention here only a few, and only from the Eastern Caribbean. If I try to name all from the entire Caribbean, we'd be here all day. Some Caribbeans have been sitting on the International Court of Justice, like the Honorable Justice Dr. Shahabuddin of Guyana and the Honorable Mr. Justice Patrick Robinson of Jamaica. Some Caribbeans have presided over international judicial tribunals. The Right Honorable Sir Dennis Byron came to the CCJ from being president of the UN, that's the United Nations International Criminal Tribunal for Rwanda. These are people you read about, you don't see them face to face. The Caribbean galaxy boasts numerous other eminent jurists. Dominica alone points to Dr. Nicholas Liverpool, who was an outstanding academician in Africa and in the Caribbean, and a justice of appeal before being elevated as President of the Republic of Dominica Mr. Brian Aline, former Chief Justice acting of the Eastern Caribbean Supreme Court. Not to forget legal luminaries such as F.O.C. Harris, the internationally recognized legal draftsman, and Dr. Dolliver Nelson of Grenada, accepted globally as a leading authority on the law of the sea. With university law faculties and professional law schools now rooted across the Caribbean, legal scholarship will increase in the region. A case-by-case comparison of judicial decisions handed down by the Privy Council and those reached by Caribbean courts would not tell the whole story of the need for Caribbean countries to abolish appeals to the Privy Council. And while I'm about it, let me say this, I'm no recent convert to this. The first article I published back in 1975, the first one, called for Caribbean countries to get out of the Privy Council, because you can never respect yourselves if you can't settle your disputes among yourselves. It can't happen. Some comparison may, however, be useful, but I'm not going to take you through them today. I just want to say this. Often, when the Privy Council comes over as being progressive, often it is simply repeating what was said by a Caribbean judge at first instance. The Court of Appeal, a judge in the Court of Appeal. You hear a lot about Pratt and the Attorney General and how the Privy Council has been revolutionizing the right to life and freedom from inhuman justice. But do you know that it was on the advice of Sir Dennis Byron, Chief Justice, and Mr. Justice Saunders, in the Eastern Caribbean Supreme Court, on help asked for by the Privy Council, that the Privy Council went on to say that the mandatory imposition of the death penalty is inhuman treatment? Do you know that? You won't read that in the books, and the Privy Council wouldn't say so. But you have to do your research, and you'll find out that that is so. Sometimes the local view in the Caribbean is better than that of the Privy Council. Sometimes, of course, yes, the Privy Council position is far better than that of the Caribbean judges in some cases. And that is not surprising. The Caribbean is not always the leader in cricket. Sometimes we're on top, sometimes we're below. That is a fact of life. And not unusually, Caribbean judges and the Privy Council have quite similar appetite on cases. They did so in correcting the error made by the Jamaican Parliament in thinking that the exception to public trials for the protection of the private lives of persons concerned therein have to do with the safety of those persons, when in fact it relates to their private affairs. But I tell you this, Your Excellency, the Privy Council is not exempt from responsibility for zigzag decision-making sometimes. The Privy Council in 1982 held that no delay in carrying out a sentence of death could make it inhuman or degrading. Right away, some Caribbean scholars objected and pointed out that that decision ought to be reversed. Next, that such a result could be produced by inordinate delay was accepted by the Privy Council in Pratt. At UKPC, the Privy Council at one time, there is nothing unusual in mandatory death sentence. The Privy Council so held in a case from Singapore. When the death sentence was being imposed, not for murder, for drug trafficking, Privy Council saw nothing wrong with that. You don't believe me? Well, go and read the case Ong Achuan and the Public Prosecutor, 1981 Appeal Cases 648. At another time, of course, the mandatory imposition of the death penalty is, in the view of the Privy Council, inhuman treatment. At one time, that penalty may not be inhuman because of a pre-constitution law saving clause. Previous to that, it was not inhuman despite such clauses. Now, if any Caribbean court, or for that matter, any court anywhere else in the third world, entered such a zigzag up and down performance, you would hear people, I don't know what they're doing. One day is this, next day is another. When the Privy Council does it, it is left to people like myself to come and point out what is going on. Another point is this. Their lordships of the Privy Council themselves admit from time to time that the Privy Council is composed of, and I quote, members who are not personally familiar with conditions in the Caribbean. They concede from time to time that a judge sitting in a local constitutional environment with which he is familiar is likely to have a surer sense of what is constitutional than, I quote, not my words, a court sitting many miles away. So they enter this confession, which is good for the soul, from time to time. Finance, economics, and geography combine to ensure that, typically in a Caribbean society, only a very small fraction of cases in civil matters reach the Privy Council. So too, indeed, with constitutional matters not related to the death penalty. Therefore, access to final appellate justice at the Privy Council is limited to only the few who are privileged financially to make the crossing from Roseau to London. Access to final appellate justice should be more widely affordable to promote equality under the rule of law. On such grounds, many Caribbeaners have been calling for the establishing of a regional Caribbean final appellate court. The Organization of Commonwealth Caribbean Bar Associations did so in 1970. Surely already others have been doing so. And the point is this then. Calls for the establishing of a final Caribbean Court of Appeal were being made, as your Attorney General showed you in a manner of speaking, since 1901, being made long before the Privy Council began moderating the death penalty to prevent it being inhuman treatment, starting in 1993. Because you may hear some people saying, it's the government that want a final court to be able to manipulate the court and to get death penalty sentences carried out. But this has been called for, in my own case, since 1975, long before Pratt came about. Now, all that debate was going on when Dominicans were framing their independence constitution. In Dominica and at the Constitutional Conference in London, 1977. On one side was the government of the Associated States of Dominica, formed by the Dominica Labour Party, led by Premier Patrick John. On the other was the opposition, formed by the Dominica Freedom Party, led by Mary Eugenia Charles. Interesting views separated the DFP from the DLP at the conference, initially at least. But those are not relevant here today. What is both relevant and important today is this. Both sides were of one accord that the Constitution on Independence Day should provide for appeals to the Privy Council in what may be called a JCPC appeals clause, reflecting a typical UKPC appeals clause, but both sides of the conference, government and opposition, were equally of one mind that the Constitution should present rather important new features regarding that clause. Namely, that a bill to alter the clause would ordinarily require approval by a majority of the votes validly cast on a referendum on the bill. But the Premier and the opposition leader agreed. By the Constitution, the requirement of referendum approval was not to apply to a bill to alter that clause in order to give effect to any agreement between Dominica and the United Kingdom concerning appeals from any court having jurisdiction in Dominica. So this clause, providing for a Dominica-UK agreement on Privy Council appeals, may be referred to as Her Ladyship, the Chief Justice of the Eastern Caribbean Supreme Court, Dame Janice Pereira, referred to it an exception provision in the amending section. I'm going to repeat that for you. An exception provision in the amending section. The Constitution has a similar clause with exception regarding a bill to alter the Supreme Court order. We won't spend time on that other clause this morning. Those two exception clauses have since materially been reproduced by three other Eastern Caribbean constitutions: St. Lucia, St. Vincent and the Grenadines, St. Kitts and Nevis. Whatever might be the requirements for substituting CCJ for the Privy Council in Caribbean constitutions without those two Dominica-type exception clauses, the real question for Dominica at the conference and coming down to today has been whether a Dominica-UK agreement on Privy Council appeals could cater both for abolishing appeals to the Privy Council and acceding to the Caribbean Court of Justice. There was a view that this could be so. The government of Prime Minister Skerrit summoned the courage to raise the question with the UK. A positive response came from the government of the UK, and for this, profound, thankful appreciation must be extended to the government of the United Kingdom. If I were a preacher, I would say, would anybody say amen to that? Well, thank you. So Dominica and the UK reached agreement in 2013. On that positive Dominica-UK agreement, the government of Prime Minister Skerrit had the Parliament of Dominica enact the Constitution of Dominica Amendment Act 2014 to substitute the Caribbean Court of Justice appellate jurisdiction for the Privy Council as the final appellate court for Dominica. Now, what is then is this Caribbean Court of Justice? It has been around for some time. You have heard this morning already, it has both an original jurisdiction and an appellate jurisdiction. You have been told about the independence of the commission which appoints the judges. I'm not going to take you through all of that again. One thing I do want to say is this. When the Caribbean Court of Justice was before the Privy Council, in that Jamaican case I referred to just now, their lordships were ruling that the Jamaicans didn't get it right. I think the Privy Council got it wrong, but that's what their lordships ruled. But the point I want to make about it is this. Even in striking down those three acts, this is what the Privy Council testified. They were looking at the agreement establishing the Caribbean Court of Justice, and they were analyzing it word by word, noting the independence of the commission, observing the provisions for financing the court through that $100 million capital fund, administered by an equally independent board of trustees. And this was the bottom line verdict of the Privy Council on the Caribbean Court of Justice. Looking at all of that, this is what their lordship said. There can be no doubt, said their lordships, that the Caribbean Court of Justice is a court of, these are their words, not my words, a court of complete independence, enjoying all the advantages which a regional court could hope to enjoy. Let me read that for you one more time. The Privy Council examining the CCJ agreement and looking at the appointments made to the court so far, having regard to all relevant considerations, put it on record that the court which today Dominique is celebrating is a court of complete independence, enjoying all the advantages which a regional court could hope to enjoy. With that sort of testimony, is there any need for me to continue talking? I don't think so. So what I'll do is I'll just quickly wrap it up in a few more minutes. And remember, their lordships were not in love with the Caribbean countries going into the court. As a matter of fact, the very president of the Privy Council, Lord Phillips, in the year 2009, September, publicly was calling upon Caribbean countries, using his own diplomatic language, but nonetheless, calling upon all Caribbean countries. This is the president of the Privy Council. I want to get that point home, Lord Phillips. And he wasn't speaking at a private cocktail party. Speaking to the press in London. So intended to be heard all over the world. Said that Caribbean cases have been taking up an inordinate amount of time of senior British judges, and it is time that Caribbean countries get out of the Privy Council and into their own final appellate court. And that's a hurtful thing for some of us, eh? Waiting until we are kicked out. The performance of the CCJ, in as much as Sir Dennis has mentioned it, I too can say that is fully discussed in detail in the book he referred to. And I'll give him a copy later this morning so he can be sure about it. So I'm not going to take you through it. I just want to mention two cases only. We have been talking federation in the Caribbean since 1947 at the Montego Bay Conference. We recognize that we cannot make it in the world, each of us individually. Great Britain recognized that Great Britain cannot make it in the world without going into Europe. The Germans, the French, they all recognize that equally. So we've been talking federation since 1947 in different ways, in different times. But nothing has happened in the Caribbean to bring a sense of the need for regionalism into our very sitting rooms at home. Leaving aside when West Indies win a cricket match, also, leaving that aside. Nothing has happened to bring home the reality of regionalism to the Caribbean than the decision of the Caribbean Court of Justice in Mairi and Barbados. Now, what happened in that case? This young lady from Jamaica, entering Barbados for the first time leaving Jamaica, is stopped at the airport in Barbados. They have no reason to believe she's up to nothing good. But they are profiling her as a Jamaican in many more ways than one. And in that profile, they are denying her entry into the country, keeping her in a cell at the airport, strip searching her with some element of indecency, and putting her on the next plane to Jamaica next morning. She goes through the procedures and gets the case before the CCJ. The Barbadians come with their best lawyers, so too the Jamaicans. In the middle is the Caribbean Court of Justice. In the end, the court finds that what was done by the Barbadian authorities had no basis in law, in justice, in righteousness. And they award her what is the equivalent of Jamaican $1 million. $1 million is $1 million in any currency. I could do it one now. And for the first time, people in the Caribbean get a sense that they have a right to go to other countries. And we allowed, as the court said initially, a period of some 6 months without having to put up a case. So the first time you know, as a Caribbeaner, yes, you can go to other countries too. This is the Magna Carta of Caribbean regionalism, in my view. I mentioned one other case. I'll give you a paper later when I go back. From the safety of Grenada, I'll send you the paper. But I take one other case. A former minister in Belize is being sued by the Attorney General of Belize. The Attorney General is alleging that the former minister had given away state lands corruptly. The question is whether you could bring a civil suit in this situation. We know you can bring criminal proceedings. They did against a former prime minister of Antigua. And he was able to persuade the Court of Appeal of the Eastern Caribbean Supreme Court that his conviction was unsound. And I think quite rightly too, indeed. So the Belizeans, they don't want to go criminal prosecution. They want to bring a civil suit against this former minister. Nowhere else in the Commonwealth would you find a case in which the court is allowing that sort of civil suit to proceed. So the question is whether the CCJ should allow such a civil suit to proceed. Now, some of the lordships in the court think that might be opening the door to abuse for victimization and spite. But every time you have a new government, the attorney general is going to bring some civil suit against a former minister. So some of the justices in the court think that is a little unsafe. Let's not go down there, not yet anyhow. The majority of the justices of the court, however, feel that and conclude that there is no clause in Adam's will which says that Caribbeaners can't make new law. So they're making this new law. And they're conscious that you can have abuse. So what do they do to prevent abuse? They say, you will have to prove bad faith on the part of the former minister, what they call malafides. In other words, the court is showing that it is not afraid to break new ground, taking care always to put in place measures of security against abuse, whichever way you go. To any reasonable observer, we have in the Caribbean Court of Justice a court that will capture the spirit of the Caribbean people. With CCJ being a court of complete independence, and CCJ being arrayed by eminent jurists, and CCJ is affording wide access, coming to pass is that great expectation of the preamble to the CCJ agreement, that the CCJ will have a determinative role in the further development of Caribbean jurisprudence. As a matter of fact, Dr. Liverpool in 2012 put it this way. Of all the CARICOM institutions that we have had, and we mean no disrespect to you, Mr. Secretary General, none has so fervidly symbolized the dignity, unity, and independence of our community and our region, says Dr. Liverpool, as the Caribbean Court of Justice. That is why accession to the appellate jurisdiction of the CCJ heralds a bright new era. I've come all this way to go back to the land of my birth to say to the people, because we are talking constitution reform in Grenada, and one of the biggest items is CCJ. And I have the responsibility as chairman of that body to go around the country and try to convince people CCJ is the way to go. So when I go back home, I can say to them, if the Dominicans can do it, we can do it too. There's nothing to be afraid of. Into this bright new era we go, led here in Dominica by a government which had the courage and the vision to take the step. And so we urge Let the highest praise go to the government of the Honourable Prime Minister Roosevelt Skerrit. And so we pray in a special way that going forward to and beyond that historic landmark, Almighty God will richly bless the government and the people of the Commonwealth of the Sovereign Democratic Republic of Dominica. Thank you very much.
Dr. Alexis, we thank you very much for sharing both the political and legal history of the Caribbean and Dominica specifically, and for elucidating so eloquently on the merits of the CCJ. Thank you very much. Our next presentation is by the Sixth Form Cicero Singers, which is one of our leading singing groups in Dominica. It was established in 1994 by the Division of Culture in collaboration with the then Sixth Form College. The choir performs a wide variety of musical genres, with Caribbean folk music being the most preferred by their local audiences. The Cicero Singers, through the medium of fine choral music, seeks to develop a cadre of responsible Dominican citizens of sound mind and character, and is guided by the motto, "Anything worth doing is worth doing well." This morning, the choir will present two pieces, Anthem from the Musical Chess and Nature Isle, composed by Jean Lawrence Mathurin and arranged by Pearl Christian. Both songs express love of country, one in a noble and sedentary way, and the other infused with pride and exuberance. Ladies and gentlemen, we present the Sixth Form Cicero Singers under the direction of Pearl Christian.
Thank you.
We thank the Cicero Singer for their presentation and as young people for the profound contribution that they're making to the country's development in song. The Honourable Roosevelt Skerrit will present to us in Several years ago, an enthusiastic, audacious young man left the comfort and stability of his position as college lecturer to embark on an unpredictable political journey, which has taken him to the pinnacle of government as Prime Minister of the Commonwealth of Dominica. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming the Honourable Roosevelt Skerrit, Prime Minister, to address us on this historic occasion.
And from one of the most wonderful villages in Dominica, Vacas. Let me first of all recognize Your Excellency Charles Angelo Savarin, our President, and Mrs. Savarin. The Right Honorable Sir Charles Michael Dennis Byron, President of the Caribbean Court of Justice, and Lady Byron. Honorable Justices of the Caribbean Court of Justice, Your Leadership, the Honorable Justice Dame Janice Pirro, our Chief Justice of the Eastern Caribbean Supreme Court. Honorable Alex Boyd Knights, Speaker of the House of Assembly. Your Lordship, Most Reverend Gabriel Malze, Bishop of Roseau. Dr. Francis Alexis, Queen's Counsel, our featured speaker at this very important historic event. Your Excellency, Mr. Elud Williams, former President of the Commonwealth of Dominica, and Mrs. Williams. Mrs. Verna Liverpool, the spouse of former President Dr. Nicholas Liverpool, whom we miss very dearly from this ceremony this morning. My colleague, Honorable Reverend Blackmore, Minister for Justice, Immigration, and National Security. Honorable Francine Barron, Minister of Foreign Affairs and CARICOM Affairs. Honorable Levi Peter, our Attorney General. Other cabinet colleagues, Honorable Lennox Linton, Leader of the Parliamentary Opposition, Your Excellency Ambassador Irwin Larock, the Secretary General of the Caribbean Community, Your Excellencies, the members of the Diplomatic and Consular Corps, and your spouses, Honorable members of the House of Assembly and spouses, Justices Bernie Stevenson and Errol Thomas, our resident judges, Monsignor Eustace Thomas, who prayed for and with us this morning. Your Worship, Irene John, the Mayor of the City of Roseau. Ambassador Steve Farrell, Secretary to the Cabinet, and Mrs. Farrell. Permanent Secretaries, Mrs. Michael Henderson Del Sol and Mr. Del Sol. Senior Counsels, Mr. Anton Estefan and Mr. Geoffrey Harris, who has some very strong links in Penville. Good morning. Members of the Bar Association, members of the media, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, friends all, Dominicans listening to this very important ceremony, both home and abroad, I bid you welcome and good morning. Today is an historic day in Dominica. For today, we take a step that makes the people of the Commonwealth of Dominica the first in the OECS to accede to the appellate jurisdiction of the Caribbean Court of Justice. Against this background, it is my pleasure, on behalf of the government and people of Dominica, to extend a gracious welcome to all of you for joining us at this historic ceremony. I am especially thankful to the President of the Court and his fellow judges for responding positively to our invitation to join us for today's event. Your esteemed presence here, Your Lordships, allows our citizens to see in the most tangible of ways that with this move, improved access to justice comes within the scope and reality of the ordinary Dominican citizen. This may seem a trite observation to some, but the reality of making more accessible and more affordable a second appellate process deepens the rights guaranteed by our Constitution and increases Dominica's ability to attract more foreign investment, for which access to the resolution of disputes and the rule of law remains critical. I would like to thank you, Sir Dennis, for your perceptive and stimulating remarks. You have reinforced our conviction that the courts is in capable, experienced, and wise judicial hands. Indeed, you will forgive me for noting that it is entirely appropriate that, as a son of the Eastern Caribbean, you should be the president of the court as our country becomes the first state from the Organization of the Eastern Caribbean States to accede to the appellate jurisdiction of the court. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, friends, it was easy for us to identify a feature speaker for this occasion. Dr. Francis Alexis currently heads Grenada's Constitution Reform Committee. He is a former lecturer at the University of the West Indies Cavill campus and has served as Attorney General in Grenada. Dr. Alexis has straddled platforms in politics, academia, government, legal practice, and consultancy. He has authored the seminal work, Changing Caribbean Constitutions. This is an essential area of study for all Commonwealth Caribbean states that have had, after a generation of independence, to reflect on how best they may perfect their constitutional and governance arrangements for the benefit of the development of our societies. One respected Grenadian lawyer described Dr. Alexis as a truly remarkable and iconic Grenadian son. I would go further and assert that he is truly a remarkable and iconic Caribbean citizen. This has been exhibited in the quality of his presentation, a discourse that not only reflected an enviable depth of legal scholarship and practical experience in the law, but also a true connection to the needs of ordinary Caribbean people. I invite you to join me in registering our deep appreciation and thanks to Dr. Alexis for his erudite contribution here today. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, the road that has led us to this day has been paved with the ambivalence that some of our brothers and sisters in the Caribbean continue to wrestle with in the search for full constitutional independence. In some respects, many of us were drawn to reflect on the spirited exchanges, on the pros and cons of political independence that filled political circles, as well as our region's media spaces in the 1960s and 1970s. Political independence is now a settled matter and is often taken for granted in most of our territories. When the Dominican flag was raised on the night of November 3, 1978, symbolizing the birth of a new and independent nation, there was an ongoing debate between the two dominant political parties of the day. The nation's first prime minister, Patrick Rowland John, embraced independence and saw it as a path to self-determination and a catalyst for national development. Mary Eugenia Charles, then leader of the opposition, compared the country to a person setting out on a journey with a few basic supplies from its colonial past. She expressed concern about the maintenance of democracy and the rule of law in the new nation. We have come a very long way since then. But that seed that would have eventually blossomed in today's symbol of constitutional independence, in my view, was planted by the one who is widely regarded as the father of this nation, Edward Oliver LeBlanc. He was a true nationalist. He taught us how to be proud of our Dominican heritage, our culture, music, dance, and folklore. He was in his time at the forefront of the action for a region to pull away from the dependence of the mother country. He was there in London at a conference where he attempted to save the West Indian Federation by the creation of the Little Eight, following the withdrawal of Jamaica and Trinidad and Tobago. In 1966, he was also there at the Lancaster House Conference to make Dominica a self-governing associate state. He was the inspiration that gave birth to a number of nationalist songs, such as Pakite Yo Point Dominic Hot Nu and Dominica, the Land of Beauty. Ladies and gentlemen, it is therefore no coincidence that the Dominica Labour Party, the party over which Mr. LeBlanc exercised a profound and lasting influence, has led the charge for full constitutional independence for Dominica. Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, fellow Dominicans, I am honored and indeed humbled to be the one leading our country at this historic moment. I have in the past argued that our country could not be truly independent if its final court of appeal was a court located in London, thousands of miles away, and tens of thousands of dollars away from the access of ordinary Dominican citizens. We complete today that third and final declaration of our sovereignty. We build today on the two earlier steps, our political independence and our determination that our head of state must be a citizen of our fair land. Over the years, there have been numerous debates and discussions of the pros and cons of adopting the Caribbean Court of Justice as our final appellate court. We began the formal process with a request of the British government for a no objection to delaying from the Privy Council. Having received a favorable response in January 2014, there was no need to proceed by way of a referendum. The way was then open to introduce a motion in the Parliament for amending the Constitution to recognize the Caribbean Court of Justice as our final appellate court. To secure this outcome, we needed the support of three quarters of the elected members of Parliament. This was achieved on Tuesday, July 1, 2014. The order bringing it into effect was issued on the 27th of February 2015. So we could have taken matters to Privy Council yesterday and the day before. So we're here today to celebrate this important milestone. Next month, on April 16th, will be the 10th anniversary of this August Caribbean Court. There is no doubt that the early phase of it being established as a hanging court to fend off the consequences of the ruling of the Privy Council in Pratt and Morgan were ill-founded. The body of Caribbean jurisprudence developed thus far attests to the wisdom displayed by the heads of government of the Caribbean community in signing the agreement on February 14, 2001, to facilitate the establishment of this court. I am not an attorney at law, but I travel the region widely. The commentary from those who have been following its work in its appellate jurisdiction, especially in Barbados and Guyana, and more recently in Belize, reinforce in our minds why this is the right and necessary step for our country. We're already aware of the difference the court has made in its original jurisdiction in protecting the rights of our citizens under the revised Treaty of Chagaramas. This was most evidently seen in the judgment in the Shanik Myrie case against the civil authorities in Barbados, which was widely published and in which a citizen of Jamaica sought to assert the rights conferred on her as a citizen of the Caribbean community. This brings me to my next point, ladies and gentlemen. While we acknowledge our accession to the Caribbean Court of Justice today, my government will ensure that we undertake a public education exercise so that all our citizens may be aware of their rights and how they can access the court in its appellate jurisdiction. I understand from what the Chief Justice has said that the court conducted sessions on this yesterday, and we pledge to build on this. We must know for which matters there will be an automatic right to appeal to the CCJ, and for which other matters we must first seek leave from the Eastern Caribbean Court of Appeal. While persons may readily access advice from the attorneys, it is always better when they do so against a background of information that is freely available to all. Fellow citizens and residents of Dominica, there are very few actions we take as a government that have no immediate financial consequences. This is one of them. On the inauguration of the court, the heads of government of the region established a trust fund, which is managed by an independent body of trustees, to ensure that the income of the trust would support the recurring budget of the court. We therefore would have made our contribution to the trust fund some 10 years ago. The foresight in the settlement of these financial arrangements is now celebrated across the democratic world, for it has insulated the court from the appearance of possible influence of any government. Our citizens should also be comforted by the fact that the Regional Judicial Services Commission is an independent body that is responsible for appointing all the justices of appeal of the court, with the exception of the president, for whose appointment there must be a qualified majority of 3/4 of the heads of government on the recommendation of the commission. Indeed, the Regional Judicial Services Commission is comprised mainly of representatives of the regional private sector and regional civil society, including, of note, representatives from the bar associations of the OECS and a representative of the OECS secretariat. As I indicated earlier, some of our other neighbors in CARICOM are still contending with constitutional and domestic issues and acceding to the appellate jurisdiction of the CCJ. I hope that a step taken today by the people of Dominica will aid in strengthening their resolve to make this final step in their own independence arrangements and in the enrichment of a Caribbean civilization. the ability of our people to have their matters and conflicts determined by our own judges, who can appreciate their cultural traditions and the nuance of their language, will, in my view, enhance the dispensation of justice for our people. These justices of appeal are better positioned to appreciate our wants, our needs, our mentality, and our spirit. Never doubt how important this is in the determination of cases. As simple as it may seem, words are open to several interpretations, and much depends on context and culture. For example, we do not have to explain that a lime is not a citrus fruit. When that word is used to describe a gathering of our people sharing fellowship in the midst of a carnival festivity. Finally, there is no doubt that our Caribbean jurisprudence will be strengthened. We anticipate that there will not only be the fearless efforts to protect the rights of our people or to interpret the law of those who may need further guidance, but as has already been seen by the decisions of the court, there will continue to be a healthy approach to judicial activism as we seek to transform former colonies into confident and fair independent nations. Laws may be made in Parliament, but they are perfected through the interpretation of the courts. Together, both the legislature and the judiciary play their role in the transformation of societies and the use of law as a tool of empowerment in the development process of our societies and economies. We believe that the Caribbean Court of Justice will continue to generate an important body of legal precedent and jurisprudence from which other democratic societies across the Commonwealth, founded on the same fundamental rights and freedoms guaranteed by our constitutions, will draw. We have a worthy contribution to make to the evolution of Commonwealth jurisprudence. Indeed, we note that the larger the pool of countries over which the court presides, the larger will be the pool of cases that will come before it, and the more diverse the range of cases. Your Excellencies and your Lordships, ladies and gentlemen, as I close, let me reflect on the idea that has been often asserted, that the only thing we need to do to fail as a Caribbean region is to doubt ourselves. Doubt and fear are universal emotions that paralyze people. In the name of the people of our nation, the Commonwealth of Dominica, I boldly assert our confidence in who we are as a people and what we can achieve when we set our minds to the task at hand. We shall eagerly embrace our future, fortified with the knowledge that today we bring closer to the average Dominican, not just the promise, but also the reality of what it means to be a sovereign and independent people. I commend this Caribbean Court of Justice to all Dominicans. Let this act reflect the commitment that we can always rise to higher heights when we seek to perfect the manner in which we govern ourselves and give clear and decisive expression to what we must achieve, to allow each Dominican the opportunity to be a better person. Today, with God's blessings and grace, we come one step closer to perfecting that goal. I want to say to us in the Caribbean, not only to Dominicans, that we need to show greater appreciation for the achievement of our people. Too many times we seek to question who we are as a people, to question our competence, and we believe too often that that which comes from out of our region is superior to that which is created by our people. So while we are here questioning the competence and integrity of our justices across the board, the rest of the world are admiring them and wishing that they were serving their own people. And I can say that I find it very offensive when people who I believe ought to know better are propagating that kind of notion, questioning our people and questioning our ability. We have to stand on principle, and principle should never be negotiated. We can negotiate words, but not principle. And I stand there on principle that we have what it takes, we have the human resources to advance our nation in the way that we would like to see it advance. And we have to stand on this principle at all times. So I am indeed very humbled to be the Prime Minister of this country at this time. And I want to say to you, Mr. President of the Court, that in the next 3 months of my term comes to an end on the 1st of June, I will ensure that some governments in the region take steps towards recognizing the Court. But I believe to have the credibility to urge, we need to take the lead, and that's what we have done. I thank you. May God bless the Court, may God bless our country, and may God bless our Caribbean community. Thank you. God bless you.
We extend sincere gratitude to you, sir, for your address and your continued demonstration of your government's commitment to strengthening the country's political, social, and economic development. Thank you once again. Before concluding our event this afternoon, we will have some presentations. The Honourable Roosevelt Skerrit will do a presentation to the President of the Caribbean Court of Justice, the Right Honourable Sir Dennis Byron, and then a presentation by Dr. Francis Alexis QC to the President of Dominica, and a presentation by Dr. Alexis to the Prime Minister of Dominica. And Dr. Alexis also wishes to do a presentation to the President of the CCJ, Sir Dennis Byron. So we'll have it in that order. Presentation by PM.
This is a copy of the official gazette. Gazette in Dominica's accession to the court in its current jurisdiction.
Invite Dr. Alexis to do presentation.
Excellency, talking about what we have, this book was printed right here in Roosevelt. Chapter 19 describes in detail the court into which Dominica is now going, Caribbean Court of Justice. In chapter 18, the book explains why every Caribbean country should get out of the predicament. It is therefore a great honor and privilege for me, Your Excellency, to present Your Excellency a copy of this. First time this book has seen the light of day being presented to the president. No one else has ever seen it. Prime Minister, when you spoke to me about 2 weeks ago, this book was not in existence. It was not printed. The inspiration you gave me, sir, speaking to me on the phone, drove me to the idea that this book could be ready. The fact that this book is ready to be then is to be credited to your inspiration. Mr. President of the Caribbean Court of Justice, 2 weeks ago, this book was nowhere near being in existence. Nobody knew how this book could be produced. Were it not for your resourcefulness, sir, the funds needed for printing this book could not be got. You were able to convince the Canadian that it is worthy of printing. This book should be printed. Heavily in your debt, sir, for this book. I trust that nothing in this book would make you regret what you did.
Your Excellencies, Your Lordships, we thank you very much for the courtesy of your attention this afternoon, and we invite you to some light refreshments, and as you interact with each other. We thank you, members of the head table, once again for your contribution towards this momentous occasion for us in Dominica, and congratulations to the Honourable Roosevelt Skerrit, his cabinet ministers, the government and the people of Dominica on our accession to the Caribbean Court of Justice. Thank you very much.